Let's take our Bibles tonight. Let's begin by doing just a brief review here of chapter 8 for those who missed it last time. It does kind of set us up here with chapter 9, as you'll see, as we're going into this. In chapter 8 of Daniel, Daniel begins by having a vision. And he has this vision, and the Bible describes two animals that he saw. He saw not only a ram, but he also saw a goat. The ram had, according to the scriptures, two horns, and they weren't the same length. One was longer than the other, and that was symbolizing their Medo-Persia, the empires. Remember, we started off with the Babylonian Empire, followed by Medo-Persia, followed by Greece, followed by Rome. And chapter 8 mainly focuses on Medo-Persia and Greece. By the time we come down to the goat, we have the goat, which symbolizes Greece, and the ram that symbolizes Medo-Persia. We're able to see what the Bible says later in verse 20. The ram is Medo-Persia. Verse 21, the shaggy goat is the kingdom of Greece. Greece overwhelms the ram, Medo-Persia. And Alexander the Great is part of that. He is a very swift conqueror, and this empire grows to an enormous proportion. We find then that after his death, however, there's a great deal of turmoil. Eventually, they divide the kingdom up into four different quadrants where there's generals who are in charge. There's a lot of underhandedness that goes on. The Bible pictures those four horns on top of that head of that goat. I drew the picture last week. You had to be here. Out of one of those horns grew another horn, started out, the Bible says, very small and grew to be quite large. That was a reference there to one of the Seleucid kings. Remember, they divided it into four segments. One of the Seleucid kings who, through deceit, treachery, murder, assassination, etc., gained prominence as the king there. That was Antiochus, the illustrious one, or Antiochus Epiphanes. So he is the one who the Bible is going to give prophecy about. We talked about this last time. We talked about the fact that it branches into a dual fulfillment, where when it's speaking about the little horn, the ram's identity, and or rather the goat's identity and his actions and his characteristics, it begins to describe something that's quite heinous. And it's diabolical to the point where you begin to realize that this is not just talking about Antiochus Epiphanes, but it's also a future reference to the Antichrist himself. And so those dual fulfillments, as we mentioned last time, it's almost like a movie that you're watching where you have a fade in and a fade out, where they keep the frames going and then the new frames come in. And that's kind of what you see here. You have that dual fulfillment and you're transitioning from Antiochus to the Antichrist. Here's something really that you want to focus on and remember. We are past the Aramaic section and we are in the Hebrew section. I believe that's for a design that God had to instruct the people of Israel. And what we're talking about are nations, huge empires, that were world-controlling empires that had direct impact on the people of Israel. And Israel, because of their sin, would be adversely impacted by these great empires. By the time you come to Antiochus Epiphanes, you have a terrible time for the history of Israel. We have Israel's going through a terrible time of being sacked and so forth, and it was just brutal. Antiochus was really angry with the Jews. He'd come back from a defeat down in Egypt. He comes back up. He is livid, and he just wants to make a point that his gods are more significant than Jehovah. And so by stamping on the people of Israel, he thought he could do that. He thought he could show that his gods were more powerful. Antiochus was taken out of the picture by God, not by human hands, but by God, and God engineered that, and so he is gone. In the same vein, the Antichrist will be removed by God himself as well. It will not be human hands that destroy this one world leader. You can determine in your heart and mind and understand that it is God alone who is capable of having the power and the authority to be able to bring judgment on the Antichrist. But all this is due to the fact that Israel finds themselves in a position of living in a way that is displeasing to Almighty God. They were chosen as the people of God. God had great plans for them, and they had every opportunity to be blessed. And it is because of their sin, God is saying, okay, this is what's going to happen to you. But one of the things I really find pretty spectacular, and I just can't get over it, so I'm excited about knowing it, is that if you go back through all of the judgments where God pours his judgment out upon the people of Israel, he's always very specific in what he is going to do. I mean, he just doesn't mince any words. If you do this, this is what's going to happen. And like a bunch of knuckleheads, they do it anyway, right? And God would be so gracious as to come to them and say, okay, all the way back to Noah, it's going to rain. And God told the world exactly how long it was going to rain. And when you get to the people of Israel and their disobedience, God says, you're going to go out into the wilderness and you're going to wander around for 40 years. When you're so wicked, you're going to be taken into captivity by another nation. And Jeremiah would point out specifically that that judgment is going to last for 70 years. God is doing that with his people. He is very, very specific. And you want to keep that in mind, especially as we go into chapter 9 here tonight. Because what we're going to see in chapter 9, I give you just a little capsule here, is that we're going to find in the very beginning that Daniel is praying to God. And this is where we're going to pick it up in chapter 9. He's praying his heart out that God would be merciful. Daniel has looked back through the records. He has now become privy to the teaching of and writing of Jeremiah. Specifically, he has come across a collection of books that includes Jeremiah's prophecy that this would be a judgment that would last for 70 years. And he is doing the math with this. He's taken into exile in 605 BC, and now the time's starting to get closer to the end, and he's thinking to himself, you know what? This has got to be right around the corner. And he starts to pray to God, God, be merciful to the people, be merciful. And he is calling out for God, and he's repenting on behalf of the people of Israel. And what God does is really amazing. What we're going to find is in this passage, while he is praying, he gets an answer to prayer. I mean, literally, the prayer is on his lips, and all of a sudden, Gabriel is there. And Gabriel is going to instruct him with the words from God as to what the future is going to look like for the people of Israel. And he is going to specifically point out, this is how you've violated things, and this is going to be the judgment. And he's going to say, this is how long the judgment will last. And it's very, very consistent. Now, we know that the very final judgment that is yet to come is that time of Jacob's trouble. There's 7 years of tribulation that are going to come upon the earth. And the purpose for that is God judging Israel. Remember, we've shifted to Hebrew in the language of Daniel, and we are coming to a passage that is incredibly important for us to understand. On this passage that we'll look at tonight really swings our understanding of much of the future. It's that important to understand and know. So tonight, this is all about God's revelation to his people, saying, you know what, I'm not happy with you. There is a judgment that is coming. There is a judgment that I am going to bring upon my people. But he also tells them, I'm not done with you either. They're going to come back. You're going to come back to me. And it's going to be great. After the second coming of Christ, the millennial kingdom, and all those promises, they're going to take hold, and it is going to be a glorious 1,000 years. Like the world has never seen. So this is yet coming, and all of those covenant promises that were unconditional will be met. Think of the Abraham covenant. How many have heard of the Abrahamic covenant? Okay, about half the class, and they're all sitting on this side. I like that. I better scooch over this way, browbeat this half, because you guys are, no. The Abrahamic covenant is one of the most predominant covenants in Scripture, and it is unconditional. God says, this is what I'm going to do, and there's no conditions involved. I like unconditional promises and covenants myself. I'm an unconditional person. You know what I'm saying? That's what I like. I like a warranty that's bumper to bumper. Everything's included, right? You can't foul it up. That's what I like. But we're going to talk about a covenant tonight that is conditional. And you'll see where the people of Israel have strayed. So join with me. Let's look here at chapter 9. I'll try to stick to the notes, although I've got so much information I don't know. We'll just do the best we can. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of Median descent, who was made king over the kingdom of the Chaldeans. Just a little note here. This is the same Darius, if you want to take a note, who we found in chapter 6. This is 13 years after the second vision that Daniel had. And Daniel's age in chapter 9 is 82. Daniel, again, the date of his captivity was 605. This Ahasuerus has nothing to do with the Ahasuerus. I knew I could get that out there. That's over there in the book of Esther. Has nothing to do with that one. All right, this is different. He's identified with Xerxes of 485 BC. Darius was actually made ruler by Cyrus. You may recall the Chaldeans. It's an interesting point here, but the Chaldeans were people who had made up the bulk, for instance, of people in the Babylonian Empire. They'd come down from the north, and I find that fascinating for certain reasons that go all the way back to Abraham. It says, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, observed in the books the number of the years which was revealed as the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet. So it's fascinating. He mentions the books. And there is an article in the Hebrew in front of that. So the books. It's not just random, I had access to the library and this is what I found. He's actually is in a privileged situation. He goes about reading through the revelation that God gave to Jeremiah the prophet. And he reads about the completion of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely, he says, 70 years. So I gave my attention, he said, to the Lord God to seek him by prayer and supplications with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed and said, alas, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant and loving kindness for those who love him and keep his commandments. We have sinned, committed iniquity, acted wickedly, and rebelled, even turning aside from your commandments and ordinances. Moreover, we have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name. I'm sure Daniel's sitting there, and he's got a copy of Jeremiah's scroll in front of him. And he's reading what Jeremiah said, and he's looking at it and going, why don't these people listen? This is the words of God that have come through the prophet, and they're not paying any attention whatsoever. And they're just going about their way sinning. Just a little bit of a notation here. Alas, O Lord, he says, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant and loving kindness. Now that's always true, isn't it? God will keep his covenant and he is faithful that way. But he says here there's a stipulation. Do you see it there? He says, for those who love him and keep his commandments. What this is a reference to, I believe, is the Mosaic Covenant. The Mosaic Covenant, as it's described in, you go to the Mosaic Covenant, you come to, for instance, Exodus chapter 20 is where the Ten Commandments are given. And you have the Ten Commandments that are all laid out. And then you have a whole host of other laws and situations. This is what I want you to do in obedience to me. And then you get into the blessings and cursings later on in Exodus 23 and also rolling into Deuteronomy. And you find all of these blessings and cursings, God just lays it right out for the people. He says, if you want to be blessed, this is what you need to do. You want to be blessed? And then people go, yeah, we want to be blessed. No, we don't want to do that. And so God says, okay, if you don't want to do that, then here are the curses. Oh, curses? Yes. God is going to judge his people if they're not obedient. And it is true, the Mosaic Covenant is the most conditional of all the biblical covenants. It is without a doubt totally dependent on man's willful desire to comply with the commandments of God and be blessed, or not. Remember, God does the same thing with the kings. Remember when the people of Israel wanted a king? And they said, hey, we want a king. We want to be like other nations. And God said, well, listen, if you do that, this is what's going to happen. They're going to take your wives and your children and your land, and they're going to beat you up every Tuesday night and eat all your food, and you're going to be poor, and you're going to hate life, and it's going to be disgusting, and it's going to get, okay, we still want it. God says, okay. I mean, at this point, dumb as a box of rocks is starting to fit. You know, I mean, it's like, wow. I mean, really? I mean, this is how do you process that? So the people of Israel have been incredibly sinful, and Daniel is trying to intercede for them, especially because he understands that these 70 years are in the midst or coming to a close. Now, there is so much material here, folks. You can just dig so deeply into Scripture. And there are people who have written on the topic of, you know, what did Daniel think? Because the question is, when does the 70 years begin, right? So if we were sitting down and we were having a little study as rabbinical students, we would be sitting there trying to figure out, well, when do you think this all happened? Well, maybe it happens in 620, maybe it happens in 605 when Daniel's exported out, and then Daniel's probably thinking to himself, oh no, what if God didn't start the 70 years until 586 when Jerusalem, you know, is sacked? I mean, you're thinking all of these numbers through. And there are a lot of considerations because he's going to tell you it's 70 years, but he doesn't tell you exactly when the start date is. And so there was no doubt a lot of conjecture and a lot of study on the part of Daniel to try to figure this out. And no doubt if Daniel's looking at this, he's thinking to himself, well, if God didn't start the clock until 586, we've got a ways to go. Maybe I'll pray, and maybe God will intervene and be merciful. So there's a lot of different things that are happening as you get through the introduction here to chapter 9. He has wonderful prayer here. I just love his prayer. Verse 7, righteousness belongs to you, O Lord, but to us open shame, as it is this day to the men of Judah, the inhabitants of Jerusalem and all Israel, those who are nearby and those who are far away, in all the countries to which you've driven them because of their unfaithful deeds which they've committed against you. Open shame belongs to us, O Lord, to our kings and our princes and our fathers, because we've sinned against you. Have you ever found yourself disgusted with the sin in your own country? But have you ever prayed a prayer, Lord, forgive us? Forgive us. I mean, is there any one of us that could stand here and say we're totally pure and have never made a mistake or never sinned? Of course not. We're part of the problem. We can also be, as children of God, part of the solution, though, because God says we're salt and light in the world in which we live. But here is Daniel, and he's not shirking any responsibility. He's taking responsibility for the condition of the hearts of the people along with them. And he's one of the most godly men we're ever going to know. In fact, I don't know as there's many more that you would look at and say, here's a man more highly to be esteemed. If you go back over there to verse 23, you find the reason God gives this to him. He says, at the beginning of your supplications, the command was issued, and I've come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed. This is someone who God is looking at and saying, here's a person who really is to be regarded among human beings as one who is a godly person. This is why God esteems him so highly. Oh, my. Oh, to be a Daniel. They should sing a song or write a song, Dare to be a Daniel. I was just thinking of that, you know. Maybe I'll write down, I'm trying to get that melody going. It is a well-placed song. So he goes on with this prayer, and basically he's asking for God to have mercy on these people. And he's not hiding the guilt. He's not hiding the responsibility and the acknowledgement. So he goes on and he says, indeed, all Israel, verse 11, has transgressed your law, turned aside, not obeying your voice. So the curse has been poured out on us along with the oath which is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, for we have sinned against him. Thus, He has confirmed his words, which he had spoken against us and against our rulers who ruled us, to bring on us great calamity. There you have that Mosaic covenant. For under the whole heaven, there has not been done anything like was done to Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come on us, yet we've not sought the favor of the Lord our God by turning from our iniquity and giving attention to your truth. People of Israel are not willing to repent and seek the Lord. They're going through tremendous calamity. They've been taken from their land, made prisoners in a foreign country. And yet no one's voice is rising to the heavens crying out for God to be merciful. The same thing is happening here in the United States. Same thing. Every time there's a terrible situation in the world, and obviously we know that this is, you know, happening more and more, and will continue, I believe, more and more because of the distance from man to God. I think as man just pushes God out of his life, these things are going to happen. There's going to be more tragedies. But where is the voice that is saying, maybe we need to listen to God? Maybe we need God to intervene. It's always someone else's fault. Have you ever noticed that? We're going to blame this or we're going to blame that. But we never look to ourselves and say, where is the blessing of God gone? The people of Israel are not looking and saying, why are we in this mess? Where is the blessing of God? They're not asking that question. They've become very self-sufficient. We live in a time that is becoming similar in the way in which we think. Because it's mind-boggling when you look at the horrors of what Israel is going through at this point, and yet there's an absolute refusal to acknowledge God. Just remember that when we get to the tribulation time and we're thinking about those 7 years of tribulation. When the world, I mean, we think, oh, yeah, this is rough. Oh, yeah, I've read people say, well, you know, 2016 is the worst year ever. And maybe it is. I don't know. But it won't be the worst year ever. There's coming some horrific times that the world, the Bible says, has never, ever even known. And people are not going to turn to God. That's the mind-boggling thing. They will continue to be angry with God and curse him. Verse 14, therefore the Lord has kept the calamity in store and brought it on us. For the Lord our God is righteous with respect to all his deeds which he has done, but we have not obeyed his voice. So he goes on down through that, and he brings his supplication to the Lord, verse 17. So now, our God, listen to the prayer of your servant, to his supplications. And for your sake, O Lord, let your face shine on your desolate sanctuary. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolation and the city which is called by your name. For we are not presenting our supplications before you on account of any merits of our own, but on account of your great compassion. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and take action for your own sake. O my God, do not delay because your city and your people are called by your name. He appeals to the reputation of God Almighty. We could do the same thing in our prayers before the Lord. Well, Daniel realizes the time is already near, and while he's speaking and praying and confessing his sin and the sin of the people, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God in behalf of the holy mountain of my God, while I was still speaking in prayer, Gabriel, the man Gabriel, whom I'd seen in the vision previously, came to me in my extreme weariness about the time of the evening offering. And he gave me instruction and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I've now come forth to give you insight with understanding. At the beginning of your supplications, the command was issued, and I have come to tell you. For you are highly esteemed, so give heed to the message and gain understanding of the vision. Verses 24 through 27 follow, and we are looking here at God's response to Daniel's prayer. We have the angel Gabriel who comes, and a prophecy known as Daniel's 70 weeks is unfolding before us. Four of the most significant verses in all of prophecies, four of the most disagreed about verses from different perspectives as well. 70 weeks the Bible says, have been decreed for your people and your holy city. To finish the transgressions, to make an end of sin, to make atonement for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. We find here in this passage that there are time periods that God is giving to his people. There are time periods that are important for us to seek to try to understand. The issue here, the prophecy of the 77s, you'll see in your notes, it's God's program to restore Jerusalem and Israel. We're going to talk about, there's six parallel statements that are made there that we're going to talk about here a little bit later. But as we look at this, we see that there are 70 weeks. These have been decreed. And we want to try to understand how these 70 weeks are broken down. We'll understand that in the very basic or rudimentary part of this, we have 7, 62, and a 70th week that will come into play at the end. And these three will not all be running consecutively. It is important for us to try to understand as we go through this. I'm going to just skip down through the notes a little bit. I'll come back over the chronology as we go through it. But I want you to know, first off, that the word week is really a reference here to a unit of seven. It's a unit of seven that's being talked about here. In the Hebrew, the particular word, we would understand it as a heptad. It's a unit of seven. It could be 7 days. It could be 1 week. It could be 7 centuries. It could be 7 just about anything. But almost everyone would say that this is a reference here to 7 years. And I'm not going to go into the reason for that exactly, just because it's a little bit, it goes back and compares Scripture with Scripture and builds the case that way. And there's reasons why, when we start to pull this apart and try to identify it, that the 7 years absolutely makes the most amount of sense. So 7 sevens, if we're talking about 1 week, all right, being that 7 years, 7 weeks would be how many years? 49, correct. So the first one is 7 years, so 7 years, or 7 times 7 would be 49 years. That's what we're talking about in the first segment. And he is going to tell us when that begins. He's going to tell us that, so you are to know and discern that from the issuing of a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there will be 7 weeks, and then there will be 62 weeks. He breaks it out, and we'll understand why here in just a second. But first of all, 62 weeks. How many years is 62 weeks? If every week is equal to 7 years, we're going to multiply 7 times 62, and we're going to come up with 434 years. For a grand total of these two time periods being 483 years. So we're going to add the 434 to the 449, and we're going to come up there with 483 years. The segment here that's talked about in that first 7 years, that first 49 years rather, the 7 weeks, he's talking here, it will be built, that is speaking about Jerusalem, it will be built again with a plaza and moat, even in times of distress. Then after the 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off, and so we understand that this is how the breakdown is going to begin to take shape for us. So when you look at your notes, and I think we can flip the page here, the summary is that there are 77s, 7 and 62 are kept separate. but they are going to be chronologically in order. After the 62 sevens, the Messiah is cut off. There are some possible in start times and end times. And so what you're trying to figure out is that we have this 483 years. Where does this 483 years, what are the two points that separate the 483 years? So there's possibilities. There's various possibilities. One is, if you're looking for a decree to go back and to rebuild Jerusalem, that's the start date, right? Everybody with me? I don't want to lose anyone here. So we have 483 years. The key to understanding this is knowing where's it start and where's it end. Y'all know when your birthday is, right? That's your start date. Y'all don't know where your end date is, right? Right. So we are trying to figure out, because the Bible's going to tell us that the start date is when the decree was given to go back and rebuild Jerusalem. So we got to try to figure this out. There are three different decrees in Scripture. We could go to, for instance, the decree of Cyrus. That's number one up here on the board. The decree of Cyrus in 538, 537. There's the decree of Artaxerxes in Nehemiah. And that date, we believe, is somewhere right around 445 B.C., and then there's Artaxerxes in Ezra, which is 458 B.C. So when you pick your start time, you absolutely have to try to pick your end time. And that's where we start to have a lot of fun. Does anybody see a problem with number one up there on the board? All right, it's 50 plus years before Jesus is born. Now, what's the problem with that? The problem is, what does it say in Scripture there? It says that it's going to go from the issuing of the decree until Messiah the Prince. If Messiah the Prince hasn't yet come, right? Don't you love it when we can erase something? Because you're sitting there going, yeah, that's awesome. So we're going to erase number one. Sorry, Cyrus. Artaxerxes at the bottom is a possibility, because he's going to start in 458, and he's going to use solar years as he tries to count this down. And he's going to end about 26 A.D. 26 A.D. is the date approximately there for Jesus' baptism. And there's some really good scholars who really hold to that particular view. And, you know, I know some personally. I think they're fantastic. But there's been a little bit more work done. And so I'm going to list that as a possibility. And you'll see there on your notes, you've got possibilities on both, the start and the finish there. But you'll want to take pretty good notes maybe here. That is definitely a possibility. But I want to show you a couple of things here with this. There was a man by the name of Anderson who did some work early on with trying to figure these dates out. Let me just give you a couple of these dates. He's going to start there in March 14th in 445 B.C., and he's going to end April 6th, 32 A.D. What does he believe happens in 32 A.D.? Well, he believes the triumphal entry is what's going to take place. And so he's trying to figure out this math. You can go back to the decree, and what you will find in the Scripture is talking about there the month, which is the month of Nisan. in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, you're going to find that the scripture does go into this and does talk about it. Take your Bibles and go with me over to Nehemiah 2. Nehemiah chapter 2, and picking this up later here in verse 5, it said, I said to the king, if it please the king, and if your servant has found favor before you, send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs, that I may rebuild it. Then the king said to me, how long will your journey be, and when will you return? It pleased the king to send me, and I gave him a definite time. So here in Nehemiah chapter 2, you have a decree to head over and begin the process of rebuilding the city of Jerusalem. And you can see that there from the scriptures. So Anderson, when he's doing his work, he's actually going to begin the countdown on March the 14th, 445, and end it with the triumphal entry of Christ, April the 6th, in 32. Now, this is a view that really didn't get that much traction. And part of the reason it didn't get the traction is because he was looking here at some dates that were kind of confusing. What else happens the same year as the triumphal entry that is like the most important thing ever? Okay, the crucifixion. How many days does crucifixion take place after the triumphal entry? Like 4 days. So it's obviously the same year. Most people, however, the crucifixion, the death of Christ, did not take place in 32. It took place in what year? 33, yes. And we're able to definitively say that. That's not like sucking it out of our thumb. So there's a problem for Anderson. And Anderson goes through these mental gymnastics with all kinds of figures to try to, figure that one out. But it was always a problem for him. So Dr. Honer, who was a professor at Dallas Theological Seminary, wrote the book, The Coming Prince. And in it, he addressed some of these issues. And he found some really important things to add to this. Now, why was it even worth taking a look at? Well, it was worth taking a look at because when Anderson did the math on this, he started to count up the days and he tried to figure out 483 prophetic days. And he looked at it as in 360 days a year, and he multiplies that out by 483 years. He comes up with a terrific number of 173,880. So and he does that math and it comes out like to the day. He has to make a couple of adjustments in that period a little bit, and he does it differently with his prophetic calendar and his reckoning. But it wasn't exactly right on because of the end date. See, the end date kept being a problem, and because we knew the triumphal entry wasn't until 433, or till 33, not 32, most people just took it and chucked it. And what they did was they went with that other one, the option 3 down here. That's what the popular option was. So along comes Honer, and Honer starts to hone in on these numbers. He starts to, don't you love it? So he's starting to hone in on all these numbers, and he's starting to fine-tune some things. And what he's finding is that he goes back and he studies the whole thing with Artaxerxes to see when Artaxerxes took over for his father, because we know he's in the 20th year, and he begins to do some math with regard to that. He finds out that when the calendar is being done and Nehemiah is writing, he doesn't write on the Nisan months. He starts with Tishri and he goes to Tishri, which you're like, what is that? That's just a month, okay? And Nisan was March and April, but he was off just a little bit from some of the ways they calculated time. And they verified this by understanding how some other writers were writing historically. They were going off of that same calendar, more of a Judean type of reckoning. You come down to the change, and you go from B.C. to A.D., and what Honer found was that Anderson made a mistake when he did that, and it should not have been 445, it should have been 444, because he counted the zeros twice. There should only have been one, okay? And so that was an error that he made. And so when he started to apply the math, he went off of solar days instead of prophetic days, calculates this whole thing out, and he nails it. He nails it. It comes up to March the 10th. No, not March the 10th. March the, yeah, notes. He counts it down, and he comes to the time when we know when the crucifixion was, and he backs it out 4 days for the triumphal entry, and it's right on the money with his math. So Honer does this really airtight examination that is really, I believe, spot on. So remember this. As Daniel gives this revelation, all of this is future big time, right? I mean, we're 483 years, we're future. And yet it's coming right down to the actual. Isn't it amazing how Jesus picked that day to ride on that colt into the city of Jerusalem? Bada bing. I mean, who knew that there were going to be theologians who were going to be studying the very individual days to see if they all added up? Now, they go through, and he does the solar calendar. It's marvelous study, but I don't want to bore you with the numbers. He counts all those 483 times 365. He goes on, and he adds 116 days for, the extra days of the month, and then he has to backtrack out 25 days, and he comes up. There it is. I mean, and it's not... He's not doing fuzzy math with it. It's right on and it's legit. You can read it and you can and take a look at it. It is pretty fascinating how it all really does come together. And so when he looks at this, he sees again the triumphal entry takes place March the 30th of AD 33. So that's the date you want. And you're going to back that out and you're going to start it. In 444, okay? And that's March the 5th. So there were 25 days in between the two. So when he's looking for his end date, he's thinking crucifixion is what he's thinking. And it doesn't add up to crucifixion. And then he remembers the 25 days. He changes the 25 days on it, and boom, what does it come out to? It comes out to triumphal entry. And it's like, wow. Okay, you know, remember the triumphal entry, that's a whole Jewish thing, right? I mean, that's coming, and theologians will go back and forth. Did Christ offer the kingdom? Did he not offer it? And you can get into all of those sidebars if you have the time and desire to be able to do that, all right? So this is how these dates lay out, and I believe that it's accurate. I believe it's right there. The key point, though, is that you want to keep in mind. Let's go back to Daniel. Let me just show you that. Verse 26, it says, then after the 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off. So that 173,880 days or whatever, it is after that. That's the conclusion of the 62 weeks. It's after that. That Messiah is cut off, okay? So I think that's a good point to understand. So I like the triumphal entry date because it's prior to the crucifixion. It seems just to line up with Scripture a little bit better, all right? We don't usually do this, but questions. I put 360 because that's how Anderson computed it. He computed it based upon prophetic calendar. If you look at, for instance, later on in the book of Revelation, and even here in Daniel, we're going to see, there's a lot of references to 42 months. There's references to a number of days, which is 3.5 years. So you see that. And those are generally calculated on that prophetic calendar. So that's the reason for the 30 days. All right. So you ready to have some more fun? Okay. So now that we've gotten through this, we want to try to figure out what else is happening here. For the Bible is going to tell us that Messiah will be cut off and have nothing, and the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now, the question that pops up is, who are the people of the prince? And sometimes there's quite a bit of discussion about that. Most amillennialists, for instance, believe that the prince there, and you'll notice probably in your Bible, in my New American Standard Bible, the prince is not capitalized there. And yet the prince up above, Messiah, the prince is capitalized. And the reason for that is that the people who did the translation work in our Bibles recognize that there are two different identities that are happening here. One is the Messiah, and the other is the Antichrist. And the amillennialists believe that the prince, the people of the prince, are the Jewish people, and the prince there is Jesus Christ. Okay, so when you think it through, the liberal way to interpret Daniel chapter 9 is to end it all when Antiochus is overturned. Okay, so they're going to start it, end it with Antiochus. They see no prophetic benefit whatsoever. The amillennial approach is going to begin and basically end with Jesus Christ. They would look at the baptism of Christ as being the beginning of the 70th week. Jesus then crucified in the middle, and then 3.5 more years after that, and it leaves it hanging, because what happens 3.5 years after Jesus dies on the cross and resurrects? What happens 3.5 years later? Right? So yeah, that's a problem. So the amillennials look at that and say, well, that's a problem, but it's kind of, well, we're looking actually at the sacking of Jerusalem in 70 AD. So it's kind of, just kind of mess with the numbers a little bit. So we just kind of move them around. But it doesn't have, for the amillennialists, there's no prophetic value to studying this passage of Scripture. It's already done. It's already been fulfilled. It's already complete. And so keep in mind, I think there's a little bit of a notation on the last sheet of your notes that talks about the amillennial position. I didn't think after working through this material that we would probably get there. But I just wanted to give you a little bit of information so you understand how we're looking at it. When we look at it from the premillennial standpoint, we're looking at the first 49 years. What is the start of the 49 years? This is the 7 weeks. What's the start? Okay, the decree. And we believe that it's not the decree in Ezra, it's the decree in Nehemiah chapter 2. I won't get into why I don't believe the other ones. Other people believe that, that's fine. I'm just telling you my best understanding is that it's Nehemiah. Where does it end? Where's the end of this first segment? End of the 49 years. So we're actually saying this starts in 444 BC. What happens here? It's a decree to what? Rebuild. the completion of the building. Okay? The completion. And then we have 62 weeks, which is 434 years. Leading up to Jesus and the promised Messiah. So that's kind of an exciting thing that we're looking at this, and Daniel is able to say that I've received this information from God, the Messiah is coming. And this is the time period where you can begin to look. Have we ever wondered, once again, where the wise men who come from the east have that information or know anything about it? Well, I think it's very clear that there's a direct connection here to Daniel and the understanding that is taking place there. This is predominantly about what people group here? Jews. This is about what people group? Jews. All right? The 70th week, which is the last week, is right there at the end. And let's look at what this passage of Scripture in front of us says. It says, after the 62 weeks, the Messiah is cut off and have nothing. And the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now, I believe that when we look at, and I am going to skip, just so you know, on page 3 of your notes, I did all kinds of work on those 6 things. Read those 6 things. They're amazing. 4 of those 6 things, that it supports the premillennial view, because 4 of them are going to be, 4 of them are going to be fulfilled by Christ as he comes and he dies on the cross. He says to finish the transgression, make an end of sin, make atonement for iniquity, and bring in everlasting righteousness. All of that happens with the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. The people of Israel are a sinful bunch, but Jesus hasn't come yet. They're not indwelt by the Holy Spirit of God like we in the church are today. And so we have to give them a little bit of grace as we understand their situation. They are still struggling, and the penalty of sin is real. There's not the victory. I got to do this. How late do we want to go? All right, if you got to leave, just get up and go. I respect that. Romans chapter 8, let me just read you a couple verses here because it really does fit pretty well. Romans 8:1 says, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Verse 1 we're familiar with pretty well. Verse 2 says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. Prior to Christ, they were not set free from this law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, in the likeness of sinful flesh, he was not sinful flesh. He condemned sin in the flesh so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So he's describing the newness of life and the victory over sin and death that the salvation brings. That is huge. That's something that the world has never known. And so when Daniel receives this prophecy, that prophecy there in verse 24 is revolutionary. It is just off the charts. It's amazing. I mean, what are you talking about? We're finally going to finish the transgression. There's going to be an end to sin? What? Isn't it amazing? Do you realize that every single person, I believe, could put their faith in Jesus Christ? Every person that lives, that hears the gospel, could put their faith in Jesus Christ and be saved and live a victorious Christian life. It's pretty amazing. That was impossible before Jesus Christ came. The next two, so you have 4 of those parallel statements. The next two, the 5th and the 6th, the 5th one is very prophetic. It says here, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy. So he's looking towards the future. That's the reason. Again, God's given to Daniel, here's the reason for the prophecy of the 70 weeks, so that you can seal up this vision and this prophecy. And then he says to anoint the most holy place, that holy of holies, to anoint it. I believe that that's a reference there. Whenever you see the holy of holies, I think there's 39 times it's used in the Old Testament, it is always being used of the temple area for the most part, or the Holy of Holies inside the, the Ark of the Covenant would be in there. So you have God saying, here are the things that you need to know, and I'm going to give it to you. Here are some that are going to be fulfilled with Jesus, and here are some yet future to that. And he says, its end will come with a flood. So the people of the prince, who is to come, if the prince, as I understand it, is a reference here, the prince, I think I'm on page 4 of your notes, and I've already mentioned the fact that there are two references. The people of the prince are speaking here about the Romans. I believe the prince, bottom of page 4, must be the Antichrist, and the people then are the Romans. They go in, and they sack Jerusalem in 70 AD. And so if we take the dates up above, we started in 444, we ended in 33 AD. It's not very long after that until this is fulfilled, and it happens. So the Romans come in, and they destroy the city and the sanctuary, and its end comes with a flood. Even to the end, there will be war. Now, he's not speaking there about a literal water flood. He's speaking about a flood of desolation. They just came in and ended it. And he says, to the end, there will be war. Desolations are determined. Now, it's very important that we understand the people of the prince, that the prince is the Antichrist, because what we see in verse 27 is very important. He will make, and the he references there, the Antichrist, that prince, he will make a firm commitment or treaty or agreement with the many, speaking about the Jewish people, for 1 week. 1 week is how long? Hey, I'm happy that you guys know that. I mean, this can be confusing. You got that down, though. That's good. So, 7 years. This is the 70th week. This is the last one. This is 7 years long. And it's important to note that, because there you have God telling the people of Israel how long, what the rest of the scripture, and when you get to the book of Revelation, you're going to find that this is described as the tribulation period. Remember, the people of Israel go into the tribulation not a friend of God in any way, shape, or form. But by the end of that 7 years, there's a turning of their hearts towards God. And there is a spiritual, a spiritual revolution on the part of the Israelites that we have never seen. And that's yet to be determined, yet future, but it will happen at the end of that week. So in verse 27, we have the Antichrist making a firm commitment with the many for 1 week. But he says in the middle of the week, he'll put a stop to sacrifice and grain offering, and on the wing of abominations will come one who makes desolate, even until a complete destruction, one that is decreed, is poured out on the one who makes desolate. A couple things here. What we've been able to note is the fact that this has been all about the Jewish people. We would look at this and we would say, this is all about the Jewish people. What's another name for the tribulation? Time of Jacob's trouble. What nationality was Jacob? Is he Irish? Of course, he's Jewish, right? So this is a time that pertains to the people of Israel, where spiritually God is bringing his wrath upon the world, and it includes the people of Israel. But you'll notice verse 27 says that prince is going to make an agreement, a treaty with the people of Israel that will last. It's supposed to last for 7 years. At the midpoint of that, he is going to break that agreement. He's going to break that treaty. And if you want to, just a point of reference there as a cross-reference, you can look at Revelation chapter 12, and I believe it's right there that this all comes to pass. We have the introduction of the great red dragon in chapter 12. We have a great sign appears in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet. That's a great illustration there of the stars in the sky and just how they've gone back and they've looked at this. It's just incredible. But the woman there is a reference to Israel, and the Bible says she has a crown of 12 stars. That's a crown that has a representation of the 12 tribes of Israel. And she was with child. And who is the most notable person to come out of the Israel? Jesus. And that is who she gives birth to. And a sign appeared in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon. So you're introduced to this great red dragon. He's identified as Satan. And the Bible describes a war in heaven in verse 7. The dragon and his angels waged war, and they were not strong enough, and there was no longer a place found for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, and the serpent of old, who's called the devil and Satan, there he is identified, who deceives the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. And I heard a voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and power in the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren has been thrown down, he who accuses them before our God day and night. Now, later on in that passage, the woman comes back into play. The woman who gave birth to the male child, verse 13. But the two wings of the great eagle were given to the woman so she could fly into the wilderness to her place where she was nourished for a, get this, time. Time is one, times, that's two, and that's 3.5 years. So 3.5 years, the people of Israel would be destroyed by Satan if it weren't for the fact that God makes provision for them and they escape into the wilderness and are able to be protected by God as the world endures the wrath of God being poured out upon them. Israel's going to enjoy the first 3.5 years of tribulation. It's going to be nice. Antichrist, he's gaining more power all the time. He's fighting wars. He's being victorious. The world is dealing with the ravages of the wrath of God being poured out. And yet the Antichrist is hovering over the people of Israel, and he's protecting them. But he's not protecting them out of his best, it's about his best interest, not theirs. He's not really concerned about them. He's concerned about protecting Jerusalem because it's there at Jerusalem and at the temple that he is going to assume what is not rightfully his, and he will sit on that throne desiring to be worshipped by the world, which has ultimately been Satan's goal since the fall. He's been working this whole thing, working it, and the only reason he's protecting it is so that it doesn't get blown to bits. At 3.5 years, Satan is cast out. He loses the battle in the heavenlies, and he's cast down to the earth, and he is angry. Think Antiochus coming back from Egypt times a bazillion. Okay? He is angry, and he comes upon the people of Israel, and God intervenes, and they're able to escape out into the wilderness. They will go through a tremendously difficult time. There is absolutely no question about it. At the very conclusion of the tribulation, the second coming happens, the second coming of Jesus, and the church will be with Jesus, the Bible says. He's going to bring us with him, and it is going to be a heavenly host like this world has never seen before. It'll be one of the most dramatic moments in the entire world. I mean, it's just going to be phenomenal. But here's the thing that I want you to keep in mind. While all these things are going on, everything that you see from way back in Daniel has been pertaining to the people of Israel. You say, well, where do we fit in? Where do we come into play as the church? Jesus died, as you know, for the sins of the whole world, Jews and Gentiles. The Jews were the first people who heard the gospel for the most part and were saved. Later, the gospel extended out to the Gentiles. And Paul describes in Romans the grafting in of the Gentiles. And we were grafted in and have become part of the body of Christ. Since that time, more Gentiles have been saved in a much larger proportion than Jews. But there are still Jews in the body of Christ. It's just that there are more Gentiles. That's the mystery that Paul talks about. He saw a mystery where the Gentiles were able to be grafted in and the body of Christ begun, and the body of Christ continues today. Today we live in the age of grace. And what we find is that there is a parenthesis. Remember, we said things tend to flow, but there is divisions. There was a division here. There's one, there's two, and there's three. And these are all very specifically laid out here in this passage. We live during this time right here. This is a parenthesis of sorts. And we don't know when this time period, the church age, will end. We don't know when it's going to end. But how is it going to end? It will end with the rapture, and that will bring to pass the beginning of the tribulation, or Daniel's 70th week. And so we know that everything up until this point here has taken place. And it's taken place exactly how God said it was going to. It's just right down there to the very day. Isn't that amazing? God just said to the people of Israel, this is what's going to happen. And he's not done. He's describing in verse 27 there in Daniel about some things that are going to happen with this prince that is to come. He is yet future. That's why we know that it's not according to the plan of the liberal perspective on this or the amillennial perspective. This is yet future. Verse 27 is yet future. We know that this is prophetic in its nature. And so when we come to the tribulation time, we have these 7 years. There's a dividing point. The Antichrist, the prince, small p, is going to come in, and one of the first things he's going to do is make a peace treaty. I heard Donald Trump say that. He said one of the first things he wants to do is make a peace treaty. Now, I'm not saying he's the Antichrist. Please don't misunderstand me. I just find it fascinating that someone would make that statement, because that's exactly what is going to happen in the future. That will become a priority of someone. The Antichrist will come in, and he will be able to do that. Donald Trump's made a lot of business deals, I understand, and he probably figures this is just one more deal, and we're going to be able to sit down and rationally understand this. This has been the bane of all of the previous presidents who have really never understood the Israeli-Arab conflict. They don't know where it really comes from. They don't understand it at all. They just think, yeah, let's get together. We'll, you know, swap a little land and have a little tea, and everything's going to be fine. And they just really, really don't get it. They really don't get it. And so this person is going to get it. But he, remember, is inspired and empowered by Satan. He is energized by Satan. And it is the devil who controls. The devil is the god of this world. And he is going to manipulate the minds of people so that the minds of people are very susceptible to the agreement that is laid out. I believe it's very supernatural, because I look at it and I go, I don't know how humanly this is really going to happen. But satanically, I believe it can. And it's something that the Bible says is going to happen. It'll happen one of the first things that the Antichrist does. He is going to be able to solve, temporarily at least, the conflict between the Jews and the Arabs. He makes that treaty. It's a 7-year treaty. Sounds good, doesn't it? Yeah. It'll be on the front page of the paper. Nobody will be reading papers by then, but, you know, it'll be on the front page. And it'll come to pass that right in the middle, because Satan gets kicked out of heaven, that there's a turning, and Satan is going to energize the Antichrist. He's going to want to be worshipped. And you go on and read Revelation 13, as we did last time, and you'll see exactly how that plays out. So we live in the parenthesis. We live in the church age. The church age is different. I don't believe, as I've gone on and talked about the rapture of the church, I don't believe that God's desire is to pour his wrath out on his bride. I don't believe that. I don't believe it's consistent with many places in the scripture, or even consistent with the character and nature of God. But God has said that you'll be spared from the wrath. He talks about that in Thessalonians, and I believe that that is the case. And so the next great event is the rapture, and following that, we will see Daniel's 70th week from up high, looking down if, if we're able or want to or whatever, but that's what's going to be occurring. So this is why Daniel chapter 9 is such a huge prophetic passage, because it's just enormous when you consider if we didn't have all of this information, you know, it would be tough to put some of those pieces together. So, but God has given to us, you know, some great information here. And hopefully we can retain it, right? Retention. It's the key, right? Retention. YouTube. Let's have a word of prayer, and I'll let you go here tonight. Father, we thank you for the word of God that we've been able to study this evening, Lord. So rich and so deep, your word. And yet, Lord, you've made it understandable. You've laid it right out for us to be able to grasp. And Lord, we give you thanks for this. We pray, Lord, for the world in which we live. And we pray for the purposes, Lord, that you've created a church. Lord, you didn't create it so that we could sit around and just wait for the trumpet. You gave us a role to play. And so we, as your ambassadors, Lord, seek to do the things that you've called us to do, to be salt and light, to be messengers, Lord, telling folks of the great gospel. And Lord, we just pray that in the days ahead, we'd be faithful to our calling. We pray, Lord, that we would truly, Lord, never give hope up. Lord, that we would be strengthened and emboldened as we study your word. Bless each one, Lord, tonight. Give us all safety as we go home, I pray. Give us a great rest of the week, and I pray this all in Christ's name.